side of it, you can have your papers spread out. You've got an ottoman that you're not using, so you can put extra work or papers or books there. You've got power for the laptop. You've got a USB that you can charge your phone or some other device, iPad. And you've got wonderful Wi-Fi, or as wonderful as it gets on a plane. It's $25.95 for the entire flight, but it does at least allow you to keep in touch when it comes to emails. So it's kind of a mobile office space, and for day flights that perhaps justifies the expense of flying business class. Then of course at night, when really it's all about sleep, you've got a fully flat bed, so presumably you get a good night's sleep and then come back productive the next day. That's the business case if you have to make it to yourself or to a travel manager. Of course, the bit you don't tell anyone is that instead of getting a good night's sleep overnight, you actually spend the 7 or 8 hours being served fantastic food and wine and watching the in-flight entertainment system. And the reason that you just couldn't do anything when you got back in the office the next day was you had a bad night's sleep. You were on the red eye. Been working too hard anyway, and really you deserve a week off just to get over it, maybe answer some emails at home. Of course, no one's going to feel sorry for anyone who's flying business class, ever. But just to make it clear, I did fly over here on a 9-hour flight in premium economy. I then queued for an hour to get through immigration at Houston, check back into the flight, and got a 9 or 10 hour flight back. So in terms of how I feel physically, it's pretty much how most business travelers feel nearly all the time. Exhausted, wanting to go to sleep, but knowing they should stay awake to do something constructive. In my case, eat all the food so that I can show it to you. Yeah, it is a tough life. There are some pretty cool storage spaces here. There's somewhere that you can store something and forget it when you leave the aircraft. Drinks, obviously, here. And this is a mirror. I'm not going to show you what's in the mirror because it's just too horrible, but you get the idea. These are the controls for the seat, which on a 9-hour flight should be enough to keep you occupied for nearly all of it. We've got a festive menu. To be honest, I think actually it's just the decoration that's festive. The meal itself is great, but not particularly Christmas orientated, thank goodness. This is the chicken biryani, main course, flying from Houston to Manchester. If we flick forward to, this has, you know, Singapore to Manchester, Manchester to Houston, and then we're on the way back, Houston to Manchester. You've got the stuff about the various wines. Oops, let's see if I can do this propped up on a wine glass. The champagne, Charles Heidsieck. Then you've got the choice of champagnes, whites and reds. Champagne, Charles Heidsieck. You've got a Riesling, the Chardonnay, which is from the USA. On the red wine side, you've got one from Bordeaux, Shiraz from McLaren Vale, Australia, and a 10-year-old tawny port. Cocktails, pretty impressive cocktails. I've only tried one, which is the Singapore Sling, which was lovely. And spirits and beer. The spirits, I don't know, headline would be Johnny Walker Black Label, Absolute Vodka Bacardi, Superior Rum, and the Bombay Sapphire. Choice of non-alcoholic beverages for people who are being sensible, including a series of mocktails. What else have we got here? Coffee selection.
Early.
And single origin at that. Guatemala, Brazil, Ethiopia. And then a tea selection from TWG. And there's certainly plenty there to keep people interested, including the Chinese tea, Asian tea, and various herbal infusions. This might seem a small detail, but one of the things I like about what they've done with this cabin is get rid of the overhead lockers over the centre seats. You know, I'm aware of the fact that might cause problems if people have got a lot of carry-on luggage. Although the ones at the side, over the aisles, over the window seats, sorry, have got more room than, you know, the old-style lockers. But what it means is you've just got so much more headroom above those seats, but also it feels more spacious. And that was one of the points of these new generation aircraft, the 787 and the A350, which we're on now, is that it would just not feel like flying so much in a metal tube. And I really do think with this design, which, let's face it, you know, isn't flashy, I think they've succeeded well with it. And this is what the seat looks like when the bed has been made up. So you've got a cushion and a pillow, duvet. Then you can see tucked around that corner is where my feet are going to go. Pretty comfortable. And now I am definitely going to bed. If I had to make a criticism, I'd say that this is actually quite narrow for your feet. The other thing is that you actually don't get an amenity bag. Pretty much everything you need is in the washrooms, you know, toothbrush, shaving, all the rest of it. But you have to actually ask for an eye mask and these ear things.